الرحيم إني جاعلك للناس إماما صلوات من أكبر In these majalis regarding the shahadat of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam We started the discussion about the concept of imamat in the Quran, keeping in mind that these days we are getting all these questions which we assume to be understood and believed in as far as the Shias are concerned. But the questions come up, you know, the doubts are sometimes created. And so last night I began the discussion that we will look at the story of Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. And we looked at this ayat from Surah Baqarah, ayat number 124, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows this position of imamat to Prophet Ibrahim. And that's where we come to realize the importance of the status of imamat. Two points which we discussed last night, I would like to continue that discussion. The first point was that this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put Ibrahim through various tests and trial, and he completed them. And then Allah says, قَالَ إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا O Ibrahim, I appoint you or make you as an imam and leader for the people. And at that time, Ibrahim, you know, expressed this desire, the wish that this position of imamat continue among his descendants. وَقَالَ مِن ذُرِّيَّتِي That was his dua. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds by saying, قَالَ لَا يَنَالُ عَهْدِ الظَّالِمِينَ That my covenant and this promise that I'm making to you does not cover those who are zalimeen. And mentioned that I'll talk about the zalimeen and what does it mean and what are the implications of this statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tonight, but we'll leave it for tomorrow night. Tonight I would like to go to this second point and continue on that. The main point that I had last night, and we looked at the ayat of Quran, that Ibrahim alayhi salam was given this position after he was already a Nabi and a Rasul. Nabi from very beginning, Rasul later on, because the issue of imamat came after the whole process where now he has Ismail, if not Ishaq also. Because his dua is for his, you know, this imamat to continue among his descendants. So before that, this couldn't have happened. And by that time, he was already a Rasul. He was more than 90 years old. That is why he's given, you know, at first time this good news about a child. The second point that we learn is that Ibrahim, among 124,000 prophets, he is among the top ones, Ulul Azm prophets. And a prophet of that status, a Rasul of that status, knew that appointing a successor or an imam was not within his authority. This was exclusively the prerogative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so he doesn't do that appointment for his children. Rather, he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This dua itself shows that this is a position which even an ulul azm peygamber cannot, you know, give it to anyone he wants. That is where we reached in that story. So let me tonight, you know, talk more about this issue of appointment of the imam, because that is the main point of disagreement between the Shias and the Sunnis, whether the appointment of the imam is based on divine choice or people's choice. What I would like to do tonight actually is present to you this scholarly assessment on this subject by a non-Muslim scholar. Sometimes it happens, you know, when you have Shia and a Sunni, okay, who will be the judge? bring somebody who is an outsider. You know, especially if you're talking about, let's say, aqli, rational, arguments. And this will be the arbitrator for us, although we don't need that, but there is a reason why I'm, bringing his assessment. And, let us see what this non-Muslim scholar says about this whole concept of the imam, appointment of the imam or the khalifa or the successor of the prophet. These are the issues that I had presented in the classes that I had on theology in February of 2016. So those of my students who had been attending, I apologize, but I'm sure they don't remember the details. So this will be a refresher for them. What I would like to present to you is actually the research work of the late Professor Wilferd Madelung. Madelung was actually a professor of Arabic in the University of Oxford. He just died a year ago, less than a year ago actually. And one of the areas of interest of this scholar was Shiaism. He had written different, articles, research papers on it. But one of his latest work was published in 1997. Interestingly, on the issue of Khilafat. The title of the book is The Succession to Muhammad, A Study of the Early Khilafat. And this was published by the Cambridge University Press. And, he has a very interesting way of looking at it. And when I read it for the first time, I was really intrigued that how come, no one from the Western scholars have ever dealt with this issue in this, depth. He actually starts with the whole issue of, let us look at the revealed religions before Islam. What was the norm as far as the appointment of the successors of the prophets in the past is concerned? And interestingly, that's our Shi'i way of also studying this whole issue. And he brings different examples, including the dua of Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. And look at his assessment here. I'll give you exact words from him, where he says, the eminent position of the families and the descendants of the past prophets and the parallelism often observed between the history of the former prophets and the Quran and that of Muhammad must raise expectation of a distinguished place reserved for his family. The first point he's making, that when you look at the prophets who came before, and the esteem and respect given to the families, we would expect the same thing for the family of Muhammad. Then he looks at different verses of the Quran about the Ahlul Bayt, especially on the rulings of khums and sadaqat and things like that. Zakat, for example, is haram for them. Then he concludes. He says, the Quran thus accorded the Ahlul Bayt of Muhammad an elevated position above the rest of the faithful, similar to the position of the families of the earlier prophets. God desired to purify them from all defilement. This is a non-Muslim scholar. This is the assessment he has of the status of the Ahlul Bayt, alayhim as-salatu was-salam. Salawat man akbar. And then he writes something immediately after this. He says, in so far as the Quran expresses the thoughts of Muhammad, it is evident that he could not have considered Abu Bakr his natural successor or have been pleased by his succession. This is not Tabarra here, this is not Munazira, this is a non-Muslim scholar's assessment of what he thinks would have been the, thinking of the Prophet. The Quran, and he continues, the Quran certainly does not fully reflect Muhammad's view about the men and women surrounding him and his attitude towards them. Yet he could not have seen his succession essentially other than in the light of the narrations of the Quran about the succession of earlier prophets. He says the prophet could not have thought about this issue in a different light than this succession of the prophets who came before. Then he says, just as he saw his own mission as a prophet, the resistance of his people which he met, and his ultimate success by divine grace in the light of the experience of the former prophets as related in the Quran. These early prophets, he says, considered it a supreme divine favor to be succeeded by their own offspring or close kin, for which they implored their Lord. So the succession by the family was considered to be a divine favor. It was not because of the community. And even for that, they didn't feel that is their right to appoint. They would implore their Lord, pray to their Lord that the succession continues in their own families. The precedence of the Quranic history, you know, leads Wilferd Madelung to believe in divine choice of a successor from the prophet's own family. Then he goes on to the Sunni perspective there. He's not finished. He says Sunnis reject this example of the prophets who came before. And he says they go to this ayat of Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, you know, he is the last prophet and that he wished. This is very important. The Sunnis say that Muhammad wished to leave the succession to be settled by the Muslims themselves on the basis of the Quranic principle of shura. Shura means, you know, consultation of the people who are elders and, you know, the people of Ahl al-Hal wal-Aqd wal-Hal. His response to the Sunni, you know, thinking is that the argument rests, now he's basically talking about their view, however, on a fanciful, wide interpretation of the term Khatimun Nabiyyin. He says, even if it means that he's the last prophet, there is no reason why it should imply that Muhammad, as the spiritual and worldly leader of the Muslim community, aside from his prophethood, should not be succeeded by his family. Remember all the ahadith of the Prophet where he says to Ali, you are to me like Harun to Musa, illa la nabiyya ba'di, except there is no nabi after me. And so this is also his own assessment. He is saying, even if Muhammad is the last prophet, doesn't prevent him from, you know, thinking about succession by his family for everything other than nubuwwat. And that is what we believe. He says that in the Quran, the descendants and close kin of the prophets are their heirs, also in respect to mulk and hukum and hikmat and book and imamat. Look at the choice of words. You know, he's saying when it comes to the issue of being the king and the ruler, being the judge in the community, in being the custodian of wisdom and knowledge, having the book, and being the imam, he says this is the position of the heirs of the prophet. Salawat manik barar. And he has one very interesting angle, which I haven't seen even Shia ulama talking about it that way. He says the Sunni concept of the true Khilafat itself defines it as a succession of the Prophet in every respect except his prophethood. So they are saying the Khulafa succeeded the Prophet fully, minus the position of prophethood. So then he's asking this question, why should Muhammad not be succeeded in this way by any of his family like the earlier prophets? Why you are denying the family of Muhammad from this position? And then he goes further, and this is what I haven't yet seen in the Shi'i writings. He says, if God really wanted to indicate that he should not be succeeded by any of them, why did he not let his grandsons or other kin die like his sons? He's saying that Allah gave sons to the Prophet, but they died in infancy. There was a reason that Allah did this. And he says, if God didn't want the family to be the heirs and successors, he could have done the same thing. Ali could have died before. Hassan and Hussein could have died before. There wouldn't have been no issue of, you know, succession by the family. And this is where he says that there is, he continues, there is this good reason to doubt that Muhammad failed to appoint a successor. You know, because we are told, oh, he didn't appoint anyone. He says there is a doubt, good reason to doubt that Muhammad failed to appoint a successor because he realized that the divine design excluded hereditary succession of his family, and that he wanted the Muslims to choose their head by Shura. You know, this is where he says that it is difficult to believe that Muhammad failed in appointing a successor. And then this is his concluding remark, where he says, the Quran advises the faithful to settle some matters by consultation, shura, but not the succession to prophets. He says that, according to the Quran, is settled by divine election. And God usually chooses their successors, whether they become prophets or not, from their own kin, from their own family. I don't know whether I should be praying for this writer. I don't know. But I wish that some Shia intellectuals and scholars in the Western universities had written things like this before this non-Muslim writer. We pray, things have been changing. There are upcoming, you know, Shia scholars, even in the Western academia, who don't shy away from carrying this identity of Shiaism. They do not apologize for being Shias. They do not even compromise in presenting their views in an academic circle. Things are changing in a positive way, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give strength to them. Salawat upon the Quran. Remember the issue of explicit and implicit? He says there is nothing about being implicit. You know, you can't even believe that Muhammad failed to appoint a successor. And he says there is a good reason to believe that he did not fail in this matter. And this is where we talk about the issue of Da'wat Zul Ashira. We talk about the issue of Ghadir. We talk about different situations where Rasulullah introduced Ali ibn Abi Talib as his Khalifa, as his Imam, and his Wasi. Salawat upon the Quran. I mentioned even last night that we are told that Saqifah was an example of democracy. Means the elders of the community got together, consulted one another, and decided that so-and-so will be the leader. And they proudly say, you know, very proudly say, this is you know, Islam is ahead of the Western democracy. If you want to really see what is the comment of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib on the issue of Shura, in words of poetry, which has been quoted by Sayyid Razi in Nahj al-Balagha, if you go to the sayings part section there, saying number 190, Ali responds to this whole issue of Saqifah by saying, فَإِن كُنْتَ بِالشُّورَى مَلَكْتَ أُمُورَهُمْ فَكَيْفَ بِهَذَا وَالْمُشِيرُونَ غَيَّبُ. If you claim to have secured this authority over the Muslims' affair by consultation, he says, فَكَيْفَ بِهَذَا. How did it happen when those who were supposed to be consulted were absent? Abdullah ibn Abbas was not there. Leave Ali aside. Even Osman was not there. Talha bin Zubair was not there. Talha was not there. Zubair was not there. Salman al-Farsi was not there. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari was not there. Ammar bin Yasir were not there. Many others, prominent Sahaba of Rasulullah, they were not there in the Saqifah. So Ali says that if you really consulted all these people who were prominent among the companions of the Prophet, what kind of consultation was there that, you know, all these prominent Sahaba were not even there? They did not even know what is going on. فَإِن كُنْتَ بِالْقُرْبَى حَجَجْتَ خَصِيمَهُمْ. If you were able to score over your opponents by بِالْقُرْبَى. You see, in Saqifah, what happened? There were two groups fighting against one another. One was the Muhajirin, Abu Bakr, Umar, and others. And then on the other side, you had Ansar, the leaders of the people of Medina, original citizens of Medina. And this is where the Muhajirin said to the Ansar that the Prophet was Quraysh, from Quraysh. We are from Quraysh. We are closely related to him than you. Therefore, we deserve to be the successors and leaders of the Ummah, you know, after Rasulullah. So Ali says, وَإِن كُنْتَ بِالْقُرْبَى حَجَجْتَ خَصِيمَهُمْ. You know, if you scored over your opponent by the Prophet's relationship, فَغَيْرُكَ أَوْلَى بِالنَّبِي وَأَقْرَبُ, then there are others who are more right on the Prophet and they are closer to Prophet than you. If that is your argument, there's another statement in Nahj al-Balagha where he says, and this is actually after the wafat of the Prophet, when Ali was told, this is what they are doing in Saqifah, he asked that person, what was the argument? He said, well, they said, we are from Quraysh. He said to the Ansar that you are not from Quraysh, we are from Quraysh. We have a right to be the leaders because Rasulullah was Qurayshi. And that is where Ali uttered those words, اِحْتَجَّ بِالشَّجَرَ وَقَطَعُ الثَّمَرَ. They argued on the basis of the relationship with the tree, but they cut off the fruits of that tree. We are the fruits of that tree. You are talking about being Qurayshi, we are Qurayshi. We are Banu Hashim. We are family of Rasulullah. If family ties with Rasul is the basis of Khilafat, we have more right on it. Salawat upon him. Let me conclude with a statement here, that when I say that Imamat is a divinely appointed position, look and study the Quran from Al-Fatiha to An-Nas. Go and do Google search on the Quran. All the ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the term imam or imams, or the term khalifa, look at all of them, and you will see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all those ayat uses the word ja'al. Jim, ayn, lam, ja'ala, which means to make something or to appoint something. For example, in Surah Baqarah, ayat number 30, talking about Adam, even before he is created, Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. Verily, I am creating or appointing a khalifa on the earth. When he talks to the malaika about Adam. Surah Baqarah again, ayat 124, which we have been discussing. Inni ja'iluka linnasi imama. Allah says to Ibrahim, I appoint you as an imam for the people. Surah 38, ayat 26, addressing Dawood. Allah says, Ya Dawood, inna ja'alnaka khalifatan fil ard. O Dawood, we have appointed you as the khalifa on the earth. Surah 21, ayat 73, Allah then talks in general about the imams. وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ عَيْمَّةً يَحْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا. We have appointed them as imams. They guide people by our command. وَوَحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِمْ فِعْلَ الْخَيْرَاتِ. We have revealed to them to do good deeds. وَإِقَامَ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِيتَاءَ الزَّكَاةِ. To establish prayers, to give in charity. وَكَانُوا لَنَا عَابِدِينَ. And they were our worshippers. Surah 32, ayat 24, again, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا. Among them, we have appointed imams who guide people by our command. Why we have chosen them? لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. Because they had this potential of sabr and patience, and they were fully convinced about the ayat that we have. Salawat Pranayak Bara. Nowhere does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about imamat and khilafat in the context of the rights of any ummah. So there is nothing there. And you saw a non-Muslim scholar's also assessment is exactly what she has been saying for centuries. Let me now just go towards the end about the issue of Ghadir that I talked about yesterday, that there is even ayat of Quran of somebody who came, Nu'man al-Fahri, who came to the Prophet and questioned him, that when you are imposing Ali on us as a Mawla and a master and a leader, is this by your wish or by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When we saw the ayat, and there is references from the Sunnis for that issue. Ali did not ignore the issue of Ghadir. Sometimes we are told, oh, why didn't Ali not talk about it? In the year 35 after Hijrah, Ali is a Khalifa now. He is in Kufa. So this is about 25 years, after the event of Ghadir we are talking about. One day he heard from the close companions, he was in his home, and the Masjid Kufa was right there, close by. And this person came and said that, Ali, there are Sahaba sitting there and they are discussing about the three Khulafa and you. And, they are saying whether you are afdal or they are afdal than you. Whether you are superior for the three or the three khulafa or they are, superior to you. Of course, Amir al-Mu'mineen became, angry, hurtful. He came to the masjid. And remember, this was not something which was announced from before. He just said, all the Sahaba, come here. This is 25 years after Ghadir. This is not in Medina, which was the center of Sahaba. This is in Kufa. Many, many years have passed. Battles took place. Many Sahaba were killed or they have died. Yet in that gathering, we see Ali stands up and he says, all those of you who were there, eyewitnesses in Ghadir, those who heard the words when the Prophet said, Man kuntu maulahu fahadha aliyul maula. He says, stand up and testify to the truth of what I'm saying. That these are the words of Rasulullah. According to the most of the sources, 24 companions of Rasul stood up. This is 25 years after that, and that's also in Kufa, remember that. Location and the time difference is very important here. 25 people in a random, unannounced gathering, they stood up and testified in the favor of Amir al-Mu'mineen that what he's talking about Ghadir and the words of the Prophet is truth. Musnad bin Ahmad bin Hanbal and Haythami's Majmu' al-Zawahid actually gives the number 30 people stood up. But there, and this is the sad part of this incident, there were a couple of people who were there, who were eyewitnesses of the event of Ghadir, yet they did not stand up. Zayd bin Arqam is one of them. On that day, he did not stand up. And Amir al-Mu'mineen, asked him that what happened? Oh, he made some excuse. And Ali at that time, and don't tell me, oh, Ali cannot do baddua. There are situations where baddua is required. Ali prayed against Zayd bin Arqam and he became blind. But because of that punishment, later on when young people would go to him and they said, Zayd bin Arqam, can you narrate a hadith for us? He was the one in every gathering will talk about Ghadir. But this is after he becomes blind because he refused to testify on that day. Another was Anas bin Malik. He also did not stand up. And Ali says to him, Ya Anas, ma yamna'uka an taquma fatashhad laqad hadartaha. Oh Anas, what happened to you? Why didn't you stand up and testify? You were there, present in Ghadir. He says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, kabirtu wa nasitu. I've become old and I've forgotten. And this is where Ali says, that Allah, if he is not true in what the excuse is giving, inflict him with leprosy that he cannot hide with the biggest of turban that he would put on his head. And we have a narration from Talha bin Umair who says that I saw after that the signs of leprosy right on the forehead of Anas bin Malik. And so for Amir al-Mu'mineen, these issues were serious issues. We cannot hide the truth of the vilayat and imamat and khilafat of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. Ali was mazloom in different ways and diminishing his fadail, bringing his status down was a very concerted effort by others, especially by Muawiyah later on. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. We have people like Ahmad bin Hanbal and others who say that in spite of, this fear of the Shias that they might be killed, and a hatred of the enemies, where the fada'il of Ali were diminished and not talked about. Yet whatever hadith we have from Rasulullah regarding Ali are so many that if you put the fada'il of the three khulafa on one side, you will see the number of the ahadith in our books for Ali supersede that. And so this was the Imam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted his name to be always high. Although people had this hatred, Khawarij was a manifestation of that hatred towards Ali. Ibn Muljim was a member of that group. And after he had attacked Amir al-Mu'mineen, Asbagh bin Nubata, one of the companions of the Imam, says that when the Banu Hashim put Ali on the carpet, on the blanket, and they were carrying him towards his home, he says, I was there, and I went to an extent where Ali stopped. And he said, tell my companions not to come close to my house, because I don't want my daughters, when they will be crying, the voice will come out, and I don't want them to hear that. You know, when he was attacked, Ali said, Fustu wa Rabbil Kaaba. He did not cry. When Hassan and Hussein and Banu Hashim came, Ali did not cry. When they put him on the blanket, he did not cry. Although he was hurt, it was painful. Ali did not cry. All the way to the house, Ali did not cry. Rather, he was actually consoling the young people of Banu Hashim and his own sons. And he was saying, you know, Allah is with you. Don't worry. I am going towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was consoling them. But you know what made Ali cry? When he entered the house, when they took him inside the house, when he saw his daughters crying on him. It was Zainab and Ummu Kulsoom and other daughters cry, which made Ali cry. As Adaran Hussain, Ali ne bahut sabr kiya hai. The doctor was called. He came and examined the wound. And according to his assessment, the poison which was there in the sword has already entered the area of the brain. He says, there is no cure for it. Ali, you should be basically now dictating your last will. And the doctor says to the family, do not feed him anything but milk. When the bowl of milk was brought to Ali, after drinking a little bit, he gave it back to the family. He says, give this to Ibn Muljim. Do not forget to feed him, and feed him the same food that you eat yourself. As Adara ne Hussain, ye jo doodh ka pyala Ali ne jo Ibn Muljim ki taraf bheja hai, ajab nahi ke Ali jo hai kufe walon se keh rahe the ke hum to apne qatil ko bhi doodh ka pyala dete hain. ایک وقت آئے گا کہ میرا بیٹا حسین کربلا میں آئے گا, تم سے بچے کے لیے دودھ نہیں مانگے گا, وہ صرف پانی کا قطرہ مانگے گا, اسے تم اذیت مت پہنچانا. لیکن ہائے کوفے والوں نے اصغر کو بجائے پانی سے سیراب کرنے سے تیر کے ذریعے سیراب کیا ہے. Allah Hussain,
علی اس درد کی کیفیت میں رہے لیکن آخری وصیت بھی جو کرتے ہیں عجیب و غریب بات ہے کہ علی نے اپنے عدل و انصاف کی اس عنوان کو ہمیشہ قائم رکھا اور رسول اسلام کو آخر وقت تک یاد کرتے رہے. جو عام وصیت کی ہے جو بچوں کے لیے بھی اور ماننے والوں کے لیے بھی ہے اور نہج البلاغہ میں موجود ہے, اس میں آخری جملہ جو ہے در حقیقت اس کے خطاب صرف فیملی سے ہے. فرماتے ہیں بنو ہاشم سے, لا یقتلن بی الا قاتلی, یاد رکھو کہ اگر ہم اس ضربت کی وجہ سے زندہ نہ رہے تو صرف میرے قاتل کو قتل کرنا اور جو اس کے خاندان کے افراد ہیں یا اس کے قبیلے والے ہیں ان پر حملہ مت کرنا. عزتداران حسین کہتے ہیں کہ اگر ہم زندہ رہیں تو ہم جانتے ہیں, لیکن اگر ہم زندہ نہ رہے, خصوصاً حسن سے کہتے ہیں فَضَرَبُوهُ ضَرْبَةً بِضَرْبَةٍ, اس نے صرف ایک وار کیا تھا, تمہیں صرف قصاص کے اعتبار سے ایک ہی وار کرنا ہے, اس کے جسم کا مسلح مت کرنا, اس لیے کہ میں نے تمہارے نانا سے یہ سنا ہے کہ کسی بھی مردے کے جسم کو ٹکڑے ٹکڑے مت کرنا, یہاں تک کہ اگر وہ کتا کبھی لاش ہو تو اسے بھی مسلامت کرنا. عجب نہیں کہ علی کوفے والوں کو تعلیم دے رہے ہیں کہ ہم تو اپنے قاتل کے لیے بھی یہ گوارا نہیں کرتے کہ اس کے جسم کے ٹکڑے ٹکڑے کر دیے جائے. میرا بیٹا جب کربلا میں, عجب نہیں کہ علی کی روح نے کیا کیفیت رہی ہوگی کہ جب گھوڑوں کو کربلا میں دوڑایا گیا اور حسین کے لاشے کو اس طرح سے پامال کیا گیا کہ سینے کی ہڈیاں زمین اپنے پشت کی ہڈیوں سے جا کے مل جاتی ہے. زینب صرف اتنا کہتی ہے, نانا آسمان کے ملائکہ پر سلام کرتے ہیں, زمین میں آ کے دیکھے نواسے کے لاش کی کس طرح سے بے حرمتی ہوئی. فاطمہ حسین,
یا حسین, یا حسین.